if he mains Jax, then you know he knows perfect this champion, and you know when he can go in or he cannot fight at all. So when you main some champion, and for example it's your area Jax or someone, you know all the matchups and you're perfect at it, you're not gonna lose a top lane, you know. You can only lose to 2v1 guys or something like this, and Jax is also strong 2v2, so I think they maybe want to play 2v2 up top. We don't know it, we have to see that, and in theory it should be easier than playing against SK or Fnatic, but you know, we're not gonna take risk, gonna take it seriously, and we're just gonna give up our best.
Welcome back to the European LCS Spring Split. I'm joined here by Lothar, coach for Giants Gaming. Welcome to the show. It's great to hear from you for the first time. I've asked every other coach I've spoken to what their role is in the team, you know, how they work with their players. And I want to know from you, what is your style? What is your approach with Giants?
Well, I watch every scrim we play, and I try to show them when we made a mistake and what we can do better. Also, I study our opponents and try to see their peak ban phase and their strategies.
All right, well, it seems to be working out. You guys started the spring split very well, going 2-0 in week one, then obviously 0-2 last week. Something struck in my mind. Adri was saying, you know, we got into LCS, we maybe didn't even expect to win any games. So my question to you is, what is the mindset like of your players? They're 2-2, and what are you doing to look after them?
Well, we had a lot of troubles in the last week, but now we're playing a lot. We're playing a lot of hours, and I think we're improving, so I think we're ready for this hard week.
Yeah, it's going to be a difficult week indeed, obviously playing up against ROCCAT. ROCCAT, a team that joined the league last year, and when they joined, they were saying, we just want to play. In spring split, they were like, we just want to be in the league. Summer split, they're like, we want to go to Worlds. What would be a success for Giants? What is it that you and your team are working towards here in the 2015 season?
Stay in the LCS.
Well, there you go. Short and simple. Best of luck with your game. We'll hear from you again soon. For the moment, we're going to send it back up to the Shark House, the desk, to take us into the game.
Thank you very much. Quick shot. Now, joining me at the desk for our final two matches of the day is Martin Linga, better known as Deficio. How you doing, man?
Beautiful. You're getting better at saying my last name.
Oh, I am. I'm getting a little bit imbibed with the Denmark. So for the time being, we're going to get into ROCCAT versus Giants. It's just moments away, but what do you think we should be looking out for in this matchup?
Well, I think Overpower said it well in the feature just before here. Look out for Whirlyb if it gets to the Jax. We know how Giants is going to play, and obviously ROCCAT should know how to try and counter it, or at least should have an option or a counter pick maybe for the Jax. I think they ban it though.
Yeah, I think that's probably the best option. Now let's go ahead and turn over to the lineups. Over on the blue side, it is ROCCAT. That means in the top lane, we'll have Overpow prowling the jungle. It's Yankos in the mid, Nuke Duck, the AD carry, Will Light, support Vander, and their coach, who has the most adorable name, it's Ducky.
Ducky, former coach of Copenhagen Wolves, of course, now swapped over to ROCCAT together with Will Light. And talking about Will Light, he's been the focus for ROCCAT in the last few games we have seen. It's been these protective Will Light comps, go full late game, he plays a hyper carry to Stana or Jinx. It just didn't pay off for them, because once he got full late game, once he got five or six items, he wasn't really able to pull his weight and actually carry his team, and they ended up losing those team fights and losing the games.
Yeah, it's kind of hard to hyper carry when you leave out the carrying part and you're just a little bit hyper. Now, the gold graph from week two, day two, looks about the same as their loss prior as well, so the strategy hasn't really shifted up too much. However, for a team with a 1-3 record, they've had such a tough schedule, ROCCAT has, that even though they're playing very defensively in general, I think they're definitely still favored over this Giants team.
Yeah, I think ROCCAT is a lot better than we see in the standings at the moment, where they're down at the bottom because they lost these three games. But still, as a team, they are too passive in their playstyle early on. They don't try to create anything. And funny enough, actually, ROCCAT as a team, they place the most wards. I mean, Vander's the support placing the most wards per minute. But all the wards are placed defensive. They never really go into the enemy jungle, place them there, light up everything and try and dive onto them or catch them out of position. No, they just sit back, wait for the other team to make some plays. And that's a thing Giants can definitely punish.
Yeah, and then, of course, if they get the picks that they've chosen, I mean, a really big question mark right now is, of course, that top lane, if Jax is given over to it or not. I don't think it will either, but I guess we'll have to see.
We're going to have to see, yeah, and we're going to have to see what the rest of Giants can do, because they are, of course, on the red side today. Whirlyb, we already talked about him in the top lane. Frederick as the jungler, Pepe Nero mid lane. Adri, of course, as the AD carry. Rydal is his support, and Losak, we just heard from him before here, as the coach.
Yeah, they mentioned that they really just want to stay in the LCS here. We'll see if they can maybe pick up a win. It's going to be a definite tough one here. And yeah, for Giants, it does seem like they've struggled to find more than one strategy as well. And we could call it in a similar sense to Fnatic. However, we just saw them branch out, not to great effect. Giants, even tougher task ahead for them to do that.
Yeah, it was very clear after week one what the tactic was going to be from Giants. Jax was banned last week in both the games they played. They lost actually pretty heavily. They fairly short games, to be honest. Giants were just going to fall behind early on. Worldly was playing Maokai in one of the games, couldn't do anything. He was playing Cassiopeia in the other one. Same deal for him. So I feel like for Giants, they got to maybe look away from the top lane, realize you won't be getting this Jax pick here, and try and find other ways to play the map. Maybe try and focus on your bottom lane a little bit. Archery has shown pretty good ability to actually carry games. He plays a lot of Jinx. Maybe try and build it around him. Also knowing that Rocket likes to go late game, build up a strong late game comp yourself and see what you can do.
Yeah, I think there's definitely a lot of options on the table for them. We'll see exactly how that one does pan out as we're getting into picks and bans here. Game number four, Giants versus ROCCAT starting up. And no surprises, there's the Jax ban.
Yeah, no surprise. All that talk from Overpower about how he could play against Worldly didn't matter anything. You just ban away Jax, don't take the chance. And this is also because Giants as a team, they don't have any other special picks you need to ban away. So you can target that Jax every single time, and you don't really have to worry about giving up too much to the rest of the members.
Yeah, Zed banned away as well. And you know, I want to touch on this mid lane matchup because these are two mid laners in a sea of very talented European mid laners that just haven't really shown up the way they've been expected. A lot of hype surrounding Nuke Duck's return and Pepinero's debut, and it just hasn't really turned into much of anything.
No, when Giants do well, which they did in week one, Pepinero is very active on the map. He will win his own lane, and then he's going to rotate to the top or to the bottom lane and really start setting up some kills. But when they're losing, he's forced to just kind of sit back, and he doesn't really have the impact on the map we would normally see from him. When Nuke Duck played LeBlanc three times, very mixed success for him. We had a great game, obviously, last week where he actually managed to get some stacks on. He didn't build a Soul Stealer this time around. He actually had quite a lot of kills, got to late game. Couldn't really do anything, though.
Yeah, now Gnar was left open as ROCCAT actually bans away Rydal's Thresh. And this is, of course, the champion that the Giants had a victory on. I mentioned it before, that was a potential weak point, was Rydal's champion pool. And then leaves Gnar open, of course. They take it away. Xerath now being figured for Giants Gaming. They also deny the Narvan combo.
Okay, so Xerath actually a ban we often see against Giants because Pepinero is known to play such a good Xerath. It was all the talk in the expansion tournament, how good he was at hitting these ulties here. And this already shows for me that Giants is going to pack towards some late game, some safety on that Xerath, some wave clear coming in. So if they actually get a hyper carry for Adri, we might see them just go for late game.
Yeah, a lot of popularity of Leona and also of Annie still this week so far, as both figuring to be picked up right now. Graves locked in for ROCCAT, so Woolite and Vander will have access to those two.
Yeah, we've actually seen today that teams pick Leona over the Annie pickup. Remember, Annie lost 10 armor and MR on her Molten Shield, which actually does hit her a bit in the laning phase, make her a bit more squishy. And now Leona is a good matchup into the Annie we have seen here in Europe multiple times. But ROCCAT still, they want their flash Tibbers from Vander, of course, and otherwise fairly standard picks from ROCCAT. No real surprise. Graves, we see him all the time in Europe as well.
Yeah, no real surprises, as you mentioned. And of course, the Corki, kind of a no-brainer on this one. Could have gone a more hyper carry choice, but that's just the popular one that's available.
Well, and also, the reason he's locking in Corki is because you now have a very, very strong siege combo already built up by Giants. By having Xerath and Corki together, your 20-minute power spike with Trinity 4 Sorcerer's Boots, of course, one or two items on Xerath, is fantastic. And this is the problem about Graves, and a good way to try and counter it. His wave clear is fairly limited to him being very close to the minions if he actually wants to clear. So he's going to get punished by Corki, by Xerath, if Giants actually group in the mid lane around this 20-minute mark.
Now, yeah, ROCCAT taking a couple of interesting picks here. The jungle Nidalee picked up for Jankos, so that one's going to get locked in pretty quickly. But they also took the Kassadin when LeBlanc was available for Nuke Duck. Of course, when you're at an 0-3 record, maybe it's time to mix things up a little bit.
And the thing is, Kassadin is actually a fairly good pick here because you just mentioned LeBlanc. Well, you don't want to pick LeBlanc into Kassadin. We already have Xerath locked in, so he knows the matchup he's playing in this situation, and it's a fairly safe lane for him. Xerath doesn't have enough mana to poke out Kassadin in the laning phase through Magic Shield, Flask, Potions, everything. So this is a free farm lane actually for Nuke Duck. in the mid lane. And obviously, we have seen this Nidalee already today. Their early game damage you can do is absolutely insane. And that's what Jankos wants to try and use here. To get that first blood, he always goes for.
Yeah, and first blood king indeed. So that is kind of what they're going for, but we have seen the not so effective Nidalee play. Oh,
right, we go Fizz
and
again.
And we got another Fizz. Okay, cool. All right. So I like this one. Same matchup before. Now, this prompts the question, does ROCCAT do the same trick Fnatic did and lane swap it up?
I think lane swapping is fine onto a Fizz. I think actually it should be the right call for ROCCAT in this situation here. But we're going to see again. They're going to swap it around. We're not going to have Xerath top lane. Don't worry. It's going to be the Trinity Force again, I believe. And it just works really well into Gnar because you got that percent magic damage on your W now every single time you hit him. So you can actually duel him one-on-one fairly easily. And we also saw once you got into team fights, once you had one or two items completed, you can still dive the AD carry. You don't 100% to zero him, but you just poke him down over and over and over as a bruiser instead of an AP burst mage.
But this does mean that the Giants have kind of tripled up on the magic damage with the Corki's mixed damage as well. So we'll see how that one works out for them in this time. A little bit one-dimensional, but you know, you have to have some confidence in picking up an assassin top laner.
True. But this, I mean, don't look at Fizz as an assassin anymore. Consider him a bruiser instead.
Fair
when
enough.
He's going into this top lane here. I've actually often seen Trinity Force into just tank, and you don't necessarily go for like Hexstringer, Blade, or the Rune King and everything, but you can do it. It gives you a lot of damage. I just want to see how Giants can use this power spike in the mid game from Xerath and Corki. If they can actually use it correctly, I don't think there's enough wave on the side of ROCCAT to defend.
Yeah, we'll have to see how they're able to play this one out. But with the picks and bans on the books, let us know who you think came out ahead. Tweet us at LOL Esports using the hashtag ROCWin or GIAWin, and we'll add up your results in the game. Now, with these lineups all taken away, all locked up, the fans starting this one up a little quieter this time. Reverence for these two teams. ROCCAT and Giants on the board. It is game four of the LCS Spring Split Week 3.
And two teams lost their games last week here, really want to bounce back. We expect more from ROCCAT, they expect more from themselves. I saw a vlog made by Jankos saying, yes, we had a tough schedule, but we didn't perform well enough. This week, however, we have Giants. We have to be able to beat them and start climbing up the standings.
Overpow has played four different champions so far in the spring split. The Gnar did not result in a win for them, however, I think this time you got to play with some confidence here against this Giant squad, even though they have the better record right now. You know, their mentality hasn't changed at 2-2. They still want to just stay in the LCS. And when you're playing from a position of fear like that, it's kind of hard to really crack a tough defensive team like ROCCAT, who are just going to wait until they get very powerful. Similar to Elements, but perhaps with a little bit more opportunity taking.
Yeah, Giants definitely will be able to create a few plays early on against ROCCAT, but they want to get that power spike on Corki Xerath. We keep talking about how 15, 20 minutes, not enough wave turn ROCCAT to defend it, so Giants has to be able to use it. And then you just 1-4 with the Fizz, getting Trinity Force, split pushing into Gnar, and suddenly you have a fairly simple setup that's going to be tough for ROCCAT to break unless they can hard engage from the likes of Vander onto the Xerath here.
Yeah, ROCCAT now. I'm going to get a little bit of warding over by the red buff. Not quite spawned up yet. They're not actually going to go for the take here, so they wander away from this and give some breathing room back to Giants as they move their way over to the blue, which is going to be spotted out.
Yeah, Noblepaw actually started sweeping lanes here. He's not going back to base to change it. So if we do have standard lanes, which we won't have, as it looks like Giants are going to lane swap in this game here onto Noblepaw, but in case we did have a lane swap going on, I would expect to see Jankos then really go to top lane, sweep out from Noblepaw to clear the ward that Willy would place, and then just have Jankos go ham and camp him completely, because again, this Nidalee, it's all about snowballing early game, because your mid game is fairly weak where you need to build up items, and that's why you need those early kills.
Yeah, now, ooh, Pepinero ghosting away as he finds Vander in his lane. He's actually making his way down bottom, but gonna be taking the slow path. One summoner burned for virtually nothing, though, so that's quite nice.
But like the ghost, though, by Pepinero, you don't need your heal in the laning phase against the Kassadin, and that ghost is gonna allow you to position yourself late game against all the mobility here from ROCCAT and kite around, because those late game team fights from Giants, you want to land the poke, you want to kite a little bit, and once ROCCAT is low enough, you turn around with the Jarvan, with the Leona, and then you just destroy a target.
I'm kind of curious that Giants are the ones who initiated this lane swap, but they have been making Overpow's life a little bit hard, and his transition to top lane hasn't been the smoothest He has done his job quite well, but ROCCAT have had some troubles here. We'll see how they do against this Giants. Flash used immediately by Nuke Duck as Rydal makes a roam of his own en route to the bottom lane.
Yeah, early roam by Rydal here. Actually not something we have seen from him too often. He prefers normally to sit in his lane and just play with archery, but now roaming around early, still staying around the mid lane. He needs to go down bottom lane here to secure Whirlyp and make sure he can actually pick up all this farm and won't get towered over by ROCCAT.
Actually, he's going to run. Yep. Right into Yankos, and actually, right. No, thank you. I'm going to back away from that one. Frederick there clearing out the Scuttle Crab.
This is a very strange lane swap by Giants because they're not freezing the top wave, they're pushing it in. And typically, if you push in the top wave, you want to dive the enemy top laner or force him away from the turret. Otherwise, he's just going to sit and get free farm, free XP. Look at Overpower, already on 16 CS. No problem, he's 1-on-1 against the Corki. He's not even falling behind in XP. So right now, because Giants didn't freeze the top wave or go for a tower dive on Overpower, he's just getting free farm, and that is not a good lane swap by Giants.
Yeah, the fact that they had Rydal swap back down to the bottom is a little curious too, just because Overpower could have the potential to solo kill Audrey in this situation. Even though Corki's incredibly mobile, has a lot of kiting potential on a Gnar, it's still not an optimal situation. You usually want to 2v1 him.
Yeah, but again, for Rydal here, simply because they weren't planning on diving on Overpower, he would have nothing to do in that lane. I mean, you're going to sit and look at Overpower farm on the turret, and so what? You're 2v1, you're not going to kill him like that. So he had to go bottom lane and secure farm on Whirlyp, but then are sharing XP, and Yankos, around this top lane here, Audrey, he needs to be careful.
Quick hunt, there's the hop, and Yankos right there. They're going to spend both his Flash and his Valkyrie. He does get away, forces them back with the Gatling gun, but it's the cost of half of his health and a summoner spell.
Yeah, and Audrey just waited for the spear to come out from Yankos. You need to connect that one to get your full damage. Obviously, the 33% extra damage on takedown, which really gives you that high amount of nuke. But mid lane, just a farm fest, not really too much going on here.
Yeah, Nuke Duck's going to be kind of at that for a little while here. He does have quite a lot of sustain in lane. Pepinero opted for the double Doran's. Pick up himself a little bit ahead on the CS, but not by a whole lot. And honestly, Azerith is somebody who can really punish an early game Kassadin.
Yeah, at least push him down in the laning phase. He won't be able to kill him. I mean, Nuke Duck is going to be safe in this lane. Even now, once he hits level 6, it's going to be pretty much impossible for Pepinero to pick up. Because you can just push it down, chip away in the tower. Get it fairly low, so once you do group, in about 10, 11 minutes time with the Corki, that tower should already have taken some damage and you can then get a free mid turret. But for now, they have to survive this lane swap and it's not looking good. Whirlyp is falling further and further behind. There's no answer for Overpower because Giants messed it up earlier when they didn't freeze the wave or go to kill him.
Yeah, really questionable decisions coming out of Giants Gaming to start this one off. However, it's still very early into the game. Things can change. It's just a little bit awkward to see them playing this out. They had a comp that looked pretty good on paper, but they just haven't executed on it. Now, Pepinero looking for a roam down bottom. He's level 6 here, and Woolite and Vander are none the wiser. Now they're going to start to back away from this one. Not quite enough to connect that stun, and Pepinero's losing out on a lot of farm for this.
Yeah, just a little bit too far away here from Rydal, but you do see a lot of pink wards replaced by Giants on the bottom side here. Because they want to try and create a play, they do have a lot of CC they can stack with the Leona and Xerath combination. Again though, Overpower 44 CS, already hit level 6. It's not even like his tower is taking a lot of damage. That could have been the play from Giants if they kept, I guess, Rydal in the top and trying to again poke down that tower. I just don't think they've gotten it down in time to even be worth it. So overall, ROCCAT can be fairly happy with this lane swap.
Yeah, they don't need to get massively ahead. They trust that their later game can do it for them. But the problem here is that Yankos hasn't really done much on the Nidalee except for in that top lane. Now, it was very successful to get the summoner burned. But you do want to start getting ahead on this one. And we saw a similar problem with Kickus in the game with Unicorn's Fnatic earlier. He just wasn't able to get very far ahead on this Nidalee.
Yeah, she normally prefers standard lane, so you can set up these ganks. And oh, Pepinero taking a little poke from Nuke Duck.
And he does not connect his damage either, so a little bit of a misplay from Pepinero. He's going to be backing to base after that trade in damage.
So we actually see Cutlass here, first item from Whirlyp. So he's going straight into Blade from him, and really just want to focus on being a one-on-one split pusher against Overpower on this piss.
Ooh, Woolite.
Woolite.
He's not taking the best trade with Audrey right there.
So this is what Giants at least did gain from the swap, is that Audrey had free XP or free farm in the lane. So he actually got level 6 before Wulat, who just managed to get it before the trade, and therefore he could push him out of the laning phase. And actually a bit missed timing from Wulat here. He needs to recall when Adri leaves the top wave or the top lane. He has to recall from Wulat so he can go back, get his BF sword, and return to lane before Adri comes down with already items bought and can just push him out of the lane. Because this actually means the bottom lane turret is taking a lot of damage because Wulat stayed in the lane too long instead of recalling when he saw Adri leave the top lane.
Yeah, so a few misplays there from ROCCAT, but it hasn't punished them too hard right now. Frederick giving that blue buff over now. Wurlip back in the top side to deal with Overpow. He's already got his Hex Drinker on. It's going to be a little hard for Wurlip to get in there and get the damage he needs out to him, especially as he started a Bilgewater Cutlass.
Again, he just wants that early blade. He's also maxing his W this time around. So just purely putting focus on percent health damage from this Fizz. And remember, we typically see Gnar go Hexdrinker into a Warmog, so he's stacking early HP, and that's where the Blade and the W really is going to counter it from Wurlip in this game here. So you might see Overpower change it up a little bit.
Yep, Pepinero just continuing to shove some damage there, clear the waves with his Arcano Pulse, and really force Nuke Duck from getting anywhere near him for the most part. However, there is always that threat of a dive-in, that's why he's saving the Shocking Orb.
And Frederick in the top lane. Finally, we have the standard lanes, and he can actually go up and camp for his top laner.
He's going to wait for Mega Gnar to run out here. Wurlip, a little bit, taking a bit of damage from the house.
Just now.
There we go. He's going to flag and drag. Smite as well, forcing the flash away from Overpow, so they do get the summoner out. And that is probably the cutest recall animation in the game.
After being Mega Gnar, which is actually pretty badass as well, where he eats the chopper and he smacks it down.
Can't get to that chopper.
Bot lane though, from Giants. Still slightly ahead on Adri because he had that solo farm early on.
Very close vote right now. The Giants fan base coming out in force. ROCCAT slightly edging them out, 51-49. This game does look pretty even across the board. I would still say ROCCAT on paper look like the favorites, but despite the misplays in the early game, Giants are giving them a run for the money.
Yeah, coming into this season here, everyone talked about how ROCCAT and made some fantastic moves in the offseason. They were going to be a contender for sure for the top spots. While Giants, nobody really gave them a chance. It was like, okay, last team to qualify through the expansion tournament, lost 3-0 to H2K. And yet, though, they have actually shown some moves when they had the perfect comp for them. Wurlip on Fizz could work something along the lines of a Jax, where you have that Bruiser power here. And Pepinero,
Flash as well. Ignite is ticking his health bar down, and that's first blood as Nuke Duck stands right in front of him for it.
Yeah, even starts recalling in front of him. But again, this is the matchup. You're not going to poke out the Kassadin, and he can keep trading with you back and forth. He has to flash, he has to sustain. And Wurlip,
looked like it was going to be a successful dive, but they misplayed that one out. Overpower in a little bit of trouble. Maybe they can still turn it around just out of tower range now. Frederick having to bail out as Jankos put the hurt on both him and Wurlip, and that was a little bit weird. Yeah, Jankos going in for round two. Can he connect the spear? Just about the range. Not quite. This do stop the recall, though. Danger zone, and Vander is actually making his way up top. Slow trap here.
Yeah, Rydal is not moving from the mid lane. He's just sitting there farming. You should go top lane right now so you can actually punish ROCCAT if they do go in for this kill.
Yep, Pepinero there,
showing himself.
Okay, so ROCCAT, don't close the trap soon
enough. Rydal is coming to late now. He could actually collapse onto them with Pepinero and being four guys from Giants, and they could have picked up a kill or two.
Yeah, really weird hesitation from ROCCAT after the first play didn't quite work out. Giants nearly turned it around, then they got it turned around on them, and at the end of the day, nobody's happy with what happened.
No. Overpower missed his ulti here just as the dive started, but he's still very far ahead in terms of farm, getting some more magic resist. There's all the AP damage of Giants in this game, and actually just keep putting pressure on Graves, get a few hits on that tower every single time, and suddenly you can take it down, go to mid lane, take that one down, and you get two towers, get some extra global gold, and you will actually get the lead from Giants. That should be the call for them. Keep pushing down his bottom lane, and obviously Pepinero, whenever he has the chance, to do the same. But right now,
they're going to draw. Tibbers right on him, and he just had no chance at all. Triple team, triple threat. And goodbye, Peppy.
Yeah, nice little roamie by Vander, and obviously Jankos. He's been looking for this first gank where he could really get on the board, get an assist at least for him this time around. It worked. Pepinero had no flash, no ghost. Easy little pickup by ROCCAT. And they were, again, notice the wards that set up beforehand. You have two pings in the river just around the mid lane towards the top side, one towards the bottom side. So they knew, okay, there's a very low chance Giants has any wards around this mid lane and they have no escapes on the Xerath. We can set this one up fairly easily. It worked for them. Got the dragon as well.
Overpower with the over the wall stun while ROCCAT secures their first dragon of the game. 13 and a half in again. It has been a little bit of a slow start. That is ROCCAT's style, to just play defensively. The Giants have been unable to really do anything about it.
Yeah, when you get two kills and you cast it in, 150 CS as well, you don't really mind the passive game too early. You defended all your turrets. Your Gnar is very far ahead in the top lane as well, at least in terms of farm. ROCCAT for now looking good. See what Giants can do in a few minutes. Get that Trinity Force completed on the Corki.
He's definitely got the gold to be able to make it happen. He hasn't gotten back quite yet. And Woolite, on the other hand, has opted to go ahead and early upgrade his boots. Maybe not too early here, a bit later in the game than when we've seen some of these items being completed.
And notice what Pepinero did as well. He actually got very early magic penetration boots. On the very first back he did, didn't complete an item. Instead, you want that early magic penetration, you want the early power from the Xerath, more damage onto the champions. And really use it to, again, try and poke out ROCCAT, but they need to be careful they don't fall too far behind. Because if ROCCAT can just engage on them every single time and win the teamfights through a very fed Kassadin, well, then you're never going to be allowed to set up a siege.
Yeah, that's going to be some serious trouble for them. He completes the Rod of Ages about the time is typically expected to, so it's not that ROCCAT is snowballing out of control doing anything crazy. They've just managed to gank Kepi twice. They get themselves a turret here. It's small leads. The Dragon is helping out too. But the problem is Giants, they're just not a team that's able to really play that well from behind, especially when you're not rocking Wurlieb's Jax. They haven't won without this champion so far.
Yeah.
And when you're this far down in CS as a Fizz in the top lane, it's a little bit difficult.
Yeah, when the Kassadin can just jump your Xerath and poke him down to 50% HP pretty much every time he wants to, it becomes even harder. No Athenes coming in from Pepinero, so not going for that early magic resist. Instead going for the Morillo. So going for the maximum damage build he can go for on the Xerath. But can he actually use it? That's going to be the question. Jankas again and Vander together. It's going to force a tower. So when you're winning these lanes and you basically can control the map just by winning your lanes early on, it's so easy for you to start roaming around and just force down these towers here, because you know Giants are not strong enough to fight you back. And that's why Giants, or ROCCAT, sorry, are descending Vander and Jankas together towards the lanes, push down a tower, get some global gold.
Yeah, when you're a little bit ahead, you might as well try to brute force it out best you can. They are going to leave Wurlieb alone with his farm for now as they look to push in the middle. Should have enough power to take this one out. But second tier turret being fired down as well, with only Woolite there to defend. So Giants are doing a good job of trying to find something for their troubles. Problem is, ROCCAT are just rotating a little bit faster.
Yeah, and again, they're just stronger right now. Look at the jungle from Giants, completely warded up. Woolite doing his best to defend the bottom lane as well. Just one wave pushing in, cleared with his ulti. This is the first time we see ROCCAT making plays in the early game. Actually going in, getting aggressive deep wards in the enemy jungle and start moving between the lanes to taking down these towers very, very fast. So that's cool to see from ROCCAT. Really starting to put some pressure on Giants.
I do like, though, that Giants have moved a little bit beyond the camp top plan. Obviously, when you're not going to get Jax or a hyper carry like that every game, it's not going to work as Woolite dodges out the Solar Flare. They have tried to grab some objectives. They have tried to slip around this ROCCAT team that they're a bit afraid to straight up fight. It's just that they're not executing it quite as well as ROCCAT is.
No, they've just been falling behind due to the lane swap going in favor of ROCCAT, and obviously Nuke Duck getting the early kills on Pepinero. And look at Jankas here, feeling pretty safe. So getting a Soul Stealer on the Nidalee once he completed his Magazine Chant.
Hey man, he's got one
really
fist.
Really looking to snowball now.
We've seen a lot of Medjay Soul Stealers out of ROCCAT.
It's a ROCCAT
usually
thing.
Nuke Duck.
It's greedy, but if you do manage to pull it off, you just win so convincingly. I mean, if you get 20 stacks on an Nidalee, you get cooldown reduction, everything, you get so much AP, your spears will still hurt, even though she lost so much AP ratio on that spear.
Well, and
a
long time ago.
What
threat is it really going to be? You're so mobile as an Nidalee at this point. Nobody on Giants are really poised to try and pick you off as long as you stay within safety. Oh, they're setting up this little bit of a Deathbrush. Wurlieb turns 90 degrees before stepping into that one. Jumps on to Nuke Duck, but can't quite catch him.
Yeah, I have to admit, I actually don't like the Soul Steal at all, because there is enough engage and lockdown from Giants to just kill Jengus in a potential team fight. So I feel like it's very risky and not needed when your Kassadin is already doing so well and you're Gnar at the same time. I mean, build fairly standard and don't risk falling really far behind or getting set back a lot if you do manage to lose a team fight, because again, there is a lot of CC on Giant side, and that's what you use to counter an initial lead.
Well, see if they can actually make that lockdown, but regardless of what the mentality of Jengus is in this situation, ROCCAT still are ahead in this game, even if it's not by a ton. They've started to build up this gold lead, starting to mount, and even though there is a lot of lockdown available from Giants, they've yet to really use it effectively.
Well, this is the first time we see them group. This is exactly what we talked about in Champs, like around 20 minutes, Cork is there. If you group up in the mid lane, the tower already takes quite a lot of damage from the laning phase, and you take it down so easily. There's no proper wave clear on the side of ROCCAT.
That fish went far.
And Mist and Woolite dashing away, but still, tower went down. Giants using their comp correctly here, punishing ROCCAT for having no wave clear. Easy global goal for them. Now ward up this dragon, start poking away with Corki and Xerath, force ROCCAT away from it, take the dragon as well, and suddenly you are straight back into this game.
Yeah, it does seem to be what they're going for right now, but Overpound not too keen to let them have it. He wanders over by the dragon pit to see if they can get a collapse on this Giants team. Werlu's been left alone up in the top lane, but he's got teleport available to him. Vander, they actually run right into that pink and don't clear it away. Let's see if they want to try to burst the dragon down fast. It looks like that's exactly what they're going to do. It's going to get started. Jengus, he is locked up, as you mentioned. Has to actually catform away from this one. Right of the Arcane comes out. Woolite eats two of them, eats three of them. They secure the dragon, but a little bit low. Can they turn the fight? Rydal now in some trouble. Vander's jumped on. He's already going down. They find a big solar flare. Do they have the damage? Frederick and Rydal going low. Nuke Duck picking up the kill. It is a 3-for-1 so far, and Giants have managed to win that fight, even though they gave up a dragon to ROCCAT.
Yeah, but that was a very nice setup by Giants here. Actually, first, they walked into the dragon, set up a few wards, and then backed away, allowed ROCCAT to go in there and start it, but then the engage came in. You denied the tipples from Vander because you just locked him down instantly, killed him. Multiple kills following for Giants. Atri actually chased onto the Nuke Duck, didn't manage to get him. Therefore, he stayed alive, but ROCCAT now losing another turret.
As you mentioned, that Med Giants proved to be a risk there. Let's take a look at how that one went down.
Yeah, so again, ROCCAT has taken control of the dragon, but Giants are in a good position to actually engage onto them. A lot of damage being done while the dragon is being taken. And then you just notice how Vander here, he wants to get the tippers in, stun first with Pepper and Arrow, Rydal joins him, keep him CC locked before he can do anything. And now again, the fight is in your favor. Nuke Duck is forced to run away. Jengus can't do anything himself. Whirlip, of course, teleported behind as well and actually managed to get a kill onto Jengus.
Yeah, that was the best effort there from Overpower that they really could have expected, using the Cataclysm wall against Frederick. And all the same, Giants, they've grabbed it in back into this game. They've actually got a gold lead now, even though they're behind two of those dragons, and they're ahead in towers as a result as well. So nice move by Giants there to take advantage of a moment of weakness for ROCCAT.
Yeah, really punished ROCCAT for starting that dragon, not respecting Giants and their power spike, because again, the Corki can be much stronger than he is right now compared to the other guys we see on the field. And obviously, Xerath with this very early magic penetration, Morel and Armicon build, even went towards the Void Staffs and had as much AP as possible very early. And yet ROCCAT started the dragon, got punished for it in the teamfight here.
Oh, Nuke Duck, that was poorly timed.
Not too big of a hassle though to actually get
yeah,
out.
I should have that back in a little bit, but yeah. A little bit showing some weakness and some uncertainty from this ROCCAT squad. You know, the issue here is if they do lose this game to Giants, the record is going to be 1-4. And here we go, right of the Arcane. Nuke Duck is able to dodge one of those. But yeah, you don't want to lose this game by any means because you are just in so much trouble. We've given them a bit of a pass because they played against some really, really tough squads. But if they lose here against Giants, that is going to be something that has to seep inside your head, not in a good way.
Should definitely be a wake-up call for ROCCAT that whatever they're doing at the moment is not working for them. We're going to have to wait and see. The game is far from over yet. Giants did just manage to use that 20-minute spike really well. Two turrets, three kills as well around the dragon. And now ROCCAT can just kind of like wait it out a little bit. You have two items already completed on your Kassadin. You're waiting for second item on Woolite. Who hasn't really done too much on this Graves here. He's actually very far behind in terms of items, so he must be sitting on a lot of gold. 1,300 as we talk right now. I'm going in towards the Ghost Blade for him, which typically is an item you take if you are actually looking to snowball on the Graves, because it is weaker late game compared to like a Shiv or a Phantom Dancer. I want to see how he will use it in the fight. We might even see Rocket try and look for more skirmish and not straight up team fights, and that's why he wants the Yoma's Ghost Blade, so he has that 6 seconds of extra mobility, extra burst to win a one-on-one fight, a 2v2 fight, and that could be the option for Rocket.
Yeah, and this is a bit curious, the item choices in general for Rocket this game. Has been kind of their MO so far. Pepin Nero, though, half of his health is gone. He's ghosted on, but Nuke Duck's got the Rift Walk. Surprise! It's a Frederick, and Nuke Duck now is going to have to run his way out. Yankos actually deciding if he wanted to help him out. They're going to back off, so not aggression for just a moment, but that was a little bit wonky.
Yeah, but again, Nuke Duck's showing he can jump onto Pepin Nero whenever he wants to, meaning that Giants has to run together as a team, or at least in a 1-4 where you only have the fist split pushing so you can defend your Xerath. It's going to be all about defending Xerath and Corki now in this fight. So your Peel, even though you have great engage from Leona and Jarvan, they're going to have to use it defensively. Lock down these targets who's trying to kill your carries, and then simply just kite them out, out-sustain them in a fight, have more poke than they do, and win that way.
Yeah, Dragon up in a little over a minute. Giants definitely want to deny the third from Rocket. If they can grab it themselves, and perhaps deter or win a fight besides, it'll definitely start to put them up over Rocket here. But if Rocket answers back, or they secure the third, this is definitely going to start tilting the game in their favor.
And it's fun how every single jungle Nidalee we saw today, or we have seen today, has actually gone full AP. In solo queue, a lot of their AP Nidalee players, they go like Magus Enchant and then actually tank from there on, and like more focused on straight up team fights. Where this AP build now forces you to play extremely careful in the fights because you're so squishy and you have to just land that max range Q there, the spear onto them for the maximum damage, and then jump in with your takedown, and you can burst down a target, but if you get engaged on, like we saw Giants do around the dragon, then you won't have any impact in these fights as a jungle in Italy.
Yeah, it is a little bit troubling, and right now, Yankos definitely seems to be not able to do a whole lot with this. He did lose some Medjai stacks with that death that he had earlier on. Now, let's see if he can change his fortunes just a bit, but you're right. Full AP is very, very risky. That just seems to be how Rocket likes to play it in the item. They play defensively, gameplay, very, very aggressive with their item choices. Dragon's now spawn.
And you also force your either your top lane or support to build Locket, because you won't be building it on Nidalee as you're going for this full AP, so you have to go all in on it to actually be effective. So no Locket coming from Nidalee. You don't build a Sidestone either. That's going to cost you in terms of the vision on the map. You see Sidestone from Frederick on the side of Giants, and they have actually had more wards placed. Now, though, they need to be careful. They don't get caught in a bad position because Rocket is pushing this mid lane.
Yeah, they've just completely given up on the dragon for a moment because they want to drag Giants around. Not able to push in yet because the wave has not quite arrived, but this looks like it could be another kite around the map. Here we go, Rocket now making moves towards this dragon.
Yeah, all Rocket did here was force Giants away from the position they had at the dragon, get them into the mid lane where you can see them move down, and then you go straight for dragon yourself. You can follow them the entire way through the wards you have placed, and then you secure the dragon, you avoid all the poke, you avoid the potential engage as well. So nice little play by Rocket. So staying around, need to be careful though, because Giants want to push this mid lane.
Yeah, Rocket actually looking to maybe set something up here as Rydell checks in. Overpow might have gone a little too far forward, and he'll eat quite a lot of poke in that situation. Giants were a little too slow to react to that dragon, and maybe they're a little too slow to react to this fight. Audrey goes down. Rydell sure to follow as Overpow. Meganar hops right onto him. Woolite saved by the big Gnar from Overpow, dodging out the damage. Woolite just able to barely keep himself alive. They've lost Yankos, but they take everybody away. But Pepinero on the side of Giants.
Just the perfect fight here from Rocket. They got the flank onto Giants. Audrey as well was standing in the front line. He went down as the first guy from the Giants team here. Really poorly played team fight from them, but Rocket managed to completely capitalize on it. Let's see it again here. Notice how there's no pre-poke coming in from Giants. They're just starting to fight straight away. That's not how you want to play it. Adri as well, caught in the front line. Nuke Duck burst him down. He's dead, he's out, he's gone. And suddenly, there's not enough damage left on the side of Giants. Everyone has to run away. Rocket can clean up the fight. And this was not needed by Giants. They had a good position in the mid lane. They had the wave pushing in the top lane. If you look at the minimap as well, they didn't have to take that fight.
No, they really didn't. And the fact that they get away, look at how low over Pau and Woolite are in that situation. Just really, really magnificent use of their own jungle terrain and of collapsing when you're in that much of a lead. They had the mobility from that third dragon also helping them out after the fact.
True.
Giants just were way too slow to react in this situation, and all that lead that they'd managed to build up, all those slight positional advantages, just evaporates.
Yeah, just got a little bit too greedy from Giants and punished for it. I mean, three dragons to zero as well, so we have to worry about that one. Taking time bomb coming in. And for now again, Rocket, the Kassadin pick from Newtok is really doing work. As long as he gets the flank on and someone like Atri actually overextends, then you see what happens. Burst him down pretty much instantly.
Yeah. Now, unfortunately for Jankos, he's lost pretty much everything but one stack on that Medjay, so not really paying some dividends for him, but it's okay. Maybe he just wanted some light reading.
It works as soon as you're Kassadin, or as long as you're Kassadin pretty much doing everything you need him to.
Yeah, talk about the heavy lifting. Nukeduck.
Again, still don't like the Soul Stealer.
Hey, you know, he's stepped up quite a lot this game because Nukeduck, we talked about it in the pregame about how he hadn't quite lived up to the reputation that he had from about a year ago when he had last been competing in the LCS, but he really has made some plays this time. Let's see if he can do it again. They're going to chunk down Rydal pretty quickly. Frederick a little bit slow to the party, and a whole lot of CC was stacked right in the middle of that, but all for naught for the Giants as they lose Rydal. And now, it looks like in the middle, Rocket looking to push down some minion waves.
And Giants, again, they just keep trying to force fights onto Rocket. Don't have, basically, you just your carry sit back and poke onto Rocket here. Then you will get the advantage. You're going to force them back to base. Suddenly you can move in, get D-boards, get a tower, maybe a Baron, who knows. Use the poke you have instead of keep forcing these straight-up team fights, because it's too easy for Rocket then to actually get the right engage onto you, kill you, like they've done now for the last 5 minutes. And overall, this is a problem we've seen from Giants before. They only know one thing, and that is move forward, start fights. Not stay back, stay relaxed, don't fall too far behind, play your comp. They always look for the fights.
Well, we could say the same thing. We did say the same thing about the Unicorns of Love. However, they were able to step up, take a win against Fnatic earlier in the day. But yeah, this is still the same problem Giants have had. It's not, we've harped on the Jax a lot. It's just a classic example, not just a comfort champion for Wurlib, but what they like to do. Without that camp top strategy, without that roll into the late game strategy, they just seem to not have a backup plan other than wander around and try to pick kills.
I do think Fizz is a good pick and also replaces the Jax a little bit, as still as a split pusher who can do really well in all stages of the game. But they gotta use him then as a split pusher and not put him into these team fights over and over. Then he's not really been able to do anything. I mean, he's 1-1-1 on the fists here. We haven't actually seen him do anything in terms of split pushing. Overpower's just been walking down. He pushes up the waves and then he leaves. Whenever he knows there's a chance the fist comes down, he just backs away, walks in with his team, and waits for Giants then to engage onto them. Suddenly, Rocket wins the fight.
It's pretty much textbook description of what's been happening there. Nicely done. Giants now trying to push in a little bit in the middle, but they're being dragged around. ROCCAT, realizing they have this lead that they do, it's not massive or insurmountable by any point, but the Giants have struggled to really find an identity so far this split outside of pick Jax and camp it. So ROCCAT are able to take advantage of that indecisiveness.
Yeah, they have in this game, or at least in the end here, after Giants actually had a good move around the 20-minute mark, which has been the highlight for them in this game here. You'll see Wurlib back into this bottom lane. Your mid-game spike is over, so you don't really want to group up any longer because you don't feel safe enough against Vander, against, of course, Nukeduck on the Kassadin. Every time he has to
talk about not feeling safe.
Just jumping, like, again, this simply means Giants is not able to actually group up and play aggressive. They're going to have to wait for Rocket to make a mistake now and trying to capitalize on it in order for them to really get back and win fights. But the problem is, Dragon coming now, 12 seconds, three of them already been picked up by Rocket. Giants can't afford to give them this one, and definitely not the next one.
Well, it's certainly mobilizing to try and do it, but really, what can you do short of trying to find the perfect fight? Last time, they were able to do it with a magnificent Rydal Solar Flare, and this time, Rocket, remembering that perhaps, are going to back away from this one for just a moment.
Yeah, both teams are setting up here. Giants placing a lot of wards around them on the flanks, and there's only two ways Rocket can actually engage right here on this dragon.
It's been pulled out, but it's going to come right back into the pit.
And again, ooh, you see Giants on the bottom side of the map. Instantly, Rocket start pushing the mid lane because they want to force Giants to choose, do we want the Dragon or do we want to lose a mid turret? And that's why they're pushing it up again. Have that option open for them because they have the better positioning around this Dragon here. And right now, Giants has actually started it. Rocket is still sitting nearby. Notice Nuke Dog, he's just on the top of your screen here. You can jump the wall to blue buff and straight onto Paper Nero.
See if they're able to take this one away. Could be a smite fight. It looks like they're going to give it over for just a moment. Picked up by Nuke Dog. However, it looks like Vander was taken pretty low in that one. Yankos finally will get some more Magi stacks back. Big Gnar comes out, but it knocks them away. Audrey, extremely low. In comes Yankos, looking for more. Wurlip now caught all alone, and he just can't find the pick onto Vander. Rocket blinking health bars, but they make it out. They get the Dragon, and they get three Giants.
Yeah, and there's just no defense from Giants once Rocket start jumping the back line. There's no peel coming in. We saw the Jarvan already from Frederick actually engaging onto Rocket from his side, and suddenly your carries, they are left alone in the back. Just gonna see the replay once again. Dragon being started by Giants here. And Rocket, in this situation, they just all want to burst down Dragon and smite it at the same time to secure it, and then you take the fight. Notice how Rydal and Frederick in the front line, no protection now for Atri, no protection for Paper Nero in the back line. They end up dying for it, and Rocket just cleaning up.
In those choke points, they just do so amazingly well because it just wasn't stacked up. The CC, the damage, Giants didn't have it. Also, Frederick missed the smite. He wasn't able to save that one at all as Nuke Duck took it away. And now the Baron being started. Frederick tries to check in, but there is no way he's able to get in there and check out. Baron taking a little while, however. Red Buff is actually helping out Rocket right now because they're trying to make a decision between trying to go in on this one. Still a tense moment now. Frederick could come in for the smite steal. Baron with the spikes. Rocket a little bit low. Frederick comes in. It's secured by Yankos, however, and Frederick taken down. Rydal might be next. He does not look tanky at all. Nuke Duck gets shut down finally by Pepinero. However, it's a consolation prize and a triple kill for Woolite. Can they get even more? It looks like it. Here comes Wurlip, but Yanko says, oh no, you don't. Baron, four kills, and they only lost the Nuke Duck.
Only lost the Nuke Duck. Let's see it again here. Baron fight. A lot of damage actually from the Baron itself onto Rocket, but now, as soon as the smite misses from Frederick, he goes down. Nuke Duck is the only guy caught behind enemy lines, while the rest of Rocket here can just finish up a few kills. Get a top tower, as we see on our little pimp down here in the bottom as well.
So much damage on those spears, and that's the AP Nidalee, but also the AD Graves, and yeah, just complete mopping up after the fact. As much as Wurlip tries to make the play, they've just not got enough left in the tank. And now, Rocket have four members with Baron buff. They can shove wherever they want. They had many waves pushing against them, but now it's definitely in their favor. They've got a solid lead, they've got four dragons, and they've taken so many of these objectives on the way.
Yeah, they're really looking good right now, and have been for the last 10, 12 minutes. Once they started to get the right team fights, and Giants just kept basically running with the head first into Rocket, and now Overpower, oop, even as a Banshee, so wouldn't
he's
get
able to hop
much
away too. Yeah, he didn't even actually get that one popped, so. We
do see Righteous Glory actually from Overpower here, so he wants to add some speed up for him, and obviously Vander, so he can come in with the tippers. Not 100% relying on the flash. Kind of weird, no distortion though from Vander. He really wanted that Locket, because again, Nidalee doesn't build Locket. You have to get on either top lane or support.
Yep. Ooh, nice dash out of the fish. You can see how the gold's really trended. That little point where Giants had a bit of a lead themselves, it just completely evaporated away. And in the last couple of moments, even, Rocket have just started to, I don't even think snowball is really the appropriate word, because it's really, it kind of looks like an avalanche, although it's going up.
Yeah, I mean, it was one team fight. You see, just between the 25 and 30 minute mark, where we had that team fight in the jungle, Giants completely split up. Nuke Dog picked up a few kills. Rocket cleaned it up. I believe they got four out of five at least. Four kills out of five. And suddenly, they were just so far ahead. Giants lost their window where they were strong and could siege on turrets. And from there on and out, it's just been all in favor of Rocket. Again, they have the Baron now. Dragon is going to spawn soon. That's going to be the fifth one for them as well. So once Baron is gone, you go get the Dragon and you just continue pushing.
Yeah, and this just seems so difficult for Giants even defending this. I mean, what can they do against this team right now? Can they even grab something back in? Rydal's certainly going to try, but the rest of the team isn't with them. Where did he go? Woolite with another kill. And they can just continue to push this one in. You know, today we have seen so many Leonas just absolutely nuked Deficio. This is
yeah,
Leona Death Awareness Day, apparently.
It is not the best champion to play if you're the only guy going in, because you are still the support after all. People will just blow you up.
So much for tank stats, and yeah. There goes the inhibitor as well. ROCCAT gonna grab that one. Dragon about a minute away. They actually look like they're gonna back here, but they're taking a moment to see if they wanna maybe... Oh, actually, Giants on the chase. So they're gonna have to wait it out for just a moment.
Giants has to go straight down to this Dragon here once ROCCAT recalls. Ward it up completely and try and take a fight where you land a bit of poke beforehand. Because if you just give it up for free to ROCCAT, you're going to lose the game anyway. They're going to be way too strong. You're just going to push up mid lane, top lane, whatever, and just kill you.
Yeah, and I love how they staggered their backs, too, to not give Giants an opening to do just that. Big wave pushing against ROCCAT on the top side, but I don't think they're too worried about that. Overpass still got his teleport available. He's actually going to go clear the wave first. However, Audrey and Frederick will secure the crab, so at least they've got that going for them.
Need them deep wards. They have some walls placed around here. We still love a few more, just to really make sure you can see everything. We also see ROCCAT on the other side. They know they want the Dragon, but they also know Giants is sitting in there.
Oh, Vander! That's why you've got Moby Boots.
Dodging around. Fancy feet from Vander. Teleport coming in. There's going to be a fight.
Looks like that is the case. You can see Peppy hanging around the backside of it all. Megan are on 6 seconds on this Dragon. Neither team keen to really get themselves locked up too far into the pit, but ROCCAT so far ahead, they should be able to just start to chunk this one. Frederick's actually on the backside of the pit, and unseen to the ROCCAT eye, but here we go, Rydal going in, can they maybe find the fight? Wolite, Frederick jumping in, they found Wolite, can they blow him up? No, he is just too big. Rydal now getting chunked out, and Audrey bailing out. Yankos coming up with the pick, 4-4-0, can they make it more? It looks like it, double kill for Yankos, that's the ace. Forget Dragon boys, we're gonna end the game.
And we now have 20 stacks on the Soul Stealer from Yankos. It didn't work for him earlier, but he's just picking up so many kills here in the late game. ROCCAT pushing straight into the Nexus.
Yeah, I don't think there's really much Giants can do. They have to be alive first, and those death timers a little unforgiving at 40 minutes into this game. Towers being shredded, Nexus going down, and ROCCAT come up with win number 2 over Giants Gaming. GG, well played.
And honestly, this game, it was Giants misplaying their composition. We never got to see the fist split pushing. We had that one window around 20 minutes where they did it right, took a bad team fight after, and from there on and out, they couldn't do anything. The whole comp fell apart. ROCCAT became too strong in the 5-on-5 team fights. And obviously, Nuke Dog on this Kassadin. Two early kills, and so good in every single team fight at finding the right flanks onto Audrey, onto Pepe Nero, nuked them down, forced them out of the fight before it even started, and then ROCCAT could just take everything.
Yeah, they managed to pick up a very important second win here. And now a lot of people would have called them favored despite, of course, the record over Giants. But it's important, an important mental victory for them to be able to grab that one back in. They go into tomorrow with a little bit more confidence, especially considering because they will be, well, they're facing off Meet Your Maker, so maybe it's not going to be as tough of a week for them. But still,
yeah,
a little relieving after what was a very, very rough first 2 weeks. But all smiles now for this ROCCAT squad.
All smiles, and Yankos being denied a handshake from his own coach here. Brutal world to live in. Probably didn't approve of the Soul Stealer.
That's because the Soul Stealer.
Anyway, though, for ROCCAT, I mean, yeah, this week you have Giants, you have MOM tomorrow. We saw them play early against Elements, a very one-sided game for Elements. So this should be a 2-0 week for ROCCAT if they want to again show how good they can be. And obviously for them, right now here in the spring split, it's going to be all about getting top 6. You want to get into the playoffs, because again, it's still a fairly new lineup you have here. You want to get the synergy going, you want to make sure you have the correct playstyle with the likes of Nuke Dog and Woolite on their side.
We saw a little bit more refinement that game from Giants, or from ROCCAT, excuse me, as well, because you saw them again doing a pseudo protect the Woolite, but he wasn't on a hyper carry, so he wasn't the only priority target. Of course, Nuke Dog on that Kassadin got much more farther ahead than him, but in those fights when Woolite got taken extremely low and the focus was all on him, they did manage to peel away really, yeah, really good timely Gnar ults. And really, honestly, Gnar, I think the Gnar play around the European LCS has leveled up on a whole, because it's just been some really, really massive plays this week and really, really well done on ROCCAT's side. So I was impressed by that.
Yeah, it was very cool to see how Overpower didn't decide to be in the front line. Instead, he was looking for his AD carry and just protect him as often as he could. And he managed to time the Mega Gnar so well. It's actually a thing when we watch these games here, especially in Europe, with the Gnar. So often we see teams who mistime the Gnar ulti, and like they start a Dragon when he's sitting on zero and he's not gonna hit it during a fight, and suddenly they lose the team fight. This game here, Opa actually timed it pretty well. He was a part of every single fight. He picked up 18 assists, not a single kill, not a single death from him either. Just full tank Gnar, protect his carries, working out for ROCCAT.
Yeah, really worked out for them. And, you know, again, 2-3 record may not sound like the greatest, but, of course, this is a easier week for them. Mentally now, you've got that extra win on the board. You can go forward and just prepare for Meet Your Makers and get yourself, you know, to 3-3. Hopefully that's what they're looking to do. And even though they've still played very defensively and, of course, still hit a bit of a snag there at that point when they lost the fight at the Dragon Pit, they looked much better as a team overall.
Yeah, I have to say, early game was better from ROCCAT than we have seen before, and they won the lane swap easily because we saw the Giants fast pushing top lane and then just leaving Corki to 1-1.
I want to put on Giants maybe misplaying
yeah, of
it, but
course.
Still.
So Giants
still.
Misplaying the lane swap, and obviously ROCCAT is saying, fair enough, we take this, we get a fully farmed up Gnar. That's perfect for us. And then they actually used Jankos and Vander to go between the lanes and take down these early towers. Deep wards for once. Again, they are the team who places the most wards per minute, but just never used to place them offensively. Did this time around here, create a few picks from it. And overall, it looked a lot better for ROCCAT. We expect them to win now. We expect them to win tomorrow. And then we have to see next week what's going to happen.
Yeah, over on the other side, of course, the Giants, you know, 2-3 may not look like the worst record, of course, for a team that just wants to stay in the LCS. But, you know, they're on a 3-game losing skid now. It's not going to get any easier from here on out now that a lot of teams have sort of figured out some of that one-dimensionality. But we'll see if maybe they can go forward and come up with some different stuff. I do like the experimentation a little bit. They played the game a little bit differently. They had some, you know, moments of brilliance.
True.
Perhaps if they can just take that, refine it a lot more, they can start to be contenders because, you know, they still have a more or less decent record to start off, and a lot of teams haven't taken them too lightly as a result.
I mean, look at this game here. Had the lane swap actually worked out for them, hadn't they misplayed the lane swap, and then had they actually stuck to their what they did at 20 minutes where they grouped up and started poking and not straight up team fighting against ROCCAT or taking a bad team fight at least, they could actually have won the game because they were in a pretty good position. They were ahead in gold. They just won their team fight at Dragon as well. It was looking good for them. And then you suddenly see the misplays coming in, and from there on and out, they didn't know how to come back from it. And that's where it went wrong from Giants. So honestly, looking at this game, yes, we had some major mistakes, but they can fix it, go back and rewatch again the lane swap, and obviously know how you want to play with your Corki Zeref, and you actually can win games.
Yeah, we'll see if they're going to be able to do that going forward. Now, let's go ahead and check in at the desk where Shox is sitting down with two members of ROCCAT after that victory.
Thank you very much, Pyro. We're joined here by Woolight and Jankos after that convincing performance against Giants. Fantastic game, actually. Jankos, maybe tell me a little bit about how you approached the game, because last week was particularly rough for you guys.
Last week was rough because we faced good teams. I think we faced Elements and Fnatic, and those are like the good teams right now. So this week we're facing Giants and NYM, so we feel very confident going into those matches. We didn't prepare that much against Giants, to be fair, but we still knew that they can beat us, like obviously. But I think we did a good job and we won.
Woolight, same question goes for you, because there was a lot of pressure on your shoulders last week on those late game carries. Tristana was not available this week, so maybe that's why you guys were forced on something else. Did it have anything to do with it, actually? Or was it a conscious choice? I want to be on a more playmaker.
It's not about that I have to play hyper carries all the time. If Graves is open, for example, I think it's a much better champion because it can contribute in the early mid game more than the hyper carries. So I'm not limited to only playing hyper carries.
Yeah, you definitely looked more comfortable. We saw the jungle Nidalee again. Amazing. What was your verdict on this one? Be careful sitting right here, Janko.
Okay. I don't know. Is it actually a strat by Ducky that you guys have to build majors in every champion? Like, Nidalee, LeBlanc, like, I see it every game.
Okay, so in scrims it worked, you know, better I guess, because usually we fight a lot more in scrims and Meja is very worth it. And this game was kind of sloppy by us. I feel like the first two team fights that we had were very bad and we were out of position, kind of. So Meja didn't really work out, but at the end I still had 20 stacks. So.
Yeah.
GG for that one. Let's actually pull a replay up on the screen from a dragon fight you guys played perfectly. Let's get that up on the screen. And Woolight, I'd like you to comment on it because you were doing some fancy dashes that is great. Let's roll the clip and walk us through what happened, Woolight.
So they were starting the dragon and we kind of wanted to fight them. And then they engaged. We were forced to go on Jarvan because he was closest. He was like kind of suicided. And then when they were closed here in air to the wall, just Gnar flashed and we just follow up with all the spells. Like I ult, Corki cannot survive, and we have so many gap closes, then the perfect stun on the fist, so he just insta dies. So yeah, that was really good by us.
Fantastic by you guys.
By the way, like I saw you building like Yumus as a second item. Was that actually a conscious choice because of the enemy team composition, or was it just to actually snowball out of your lead?
Actually, I always build Yamus because I think it's better. It has better build path. You can buy longsword if you don't have money for BF in lane, and then transfer it into early brutalizer. Mm. So the build path is better, and I think it's better on Grace because the armor penetration really helps into doing damage with the QR.
Right. I'm very convinced by that explanation, not so much by the Magi's, but it worked out for you guys in the end. One more thing maybe about jungle Nidalee. You were mentioning that if you get behind a little bit, it's very hard for her to, for Nidalee to be a team fighting presence. Do you think that's the greatest weakness about her, if there's any?
Yeah, I feel like whenever I see a jungle Nidalee not being like ahead at all, I just see a champion that basically can only hear bit of poke, like, and basically engage on the front line. It's not like she can actively dive on the back line because there's no way she can one-shot them. Therefore, the return damage will be too huge, and she's basically useless. So, in my opinion, yes, Nidalee has great mid-game weakness, but if you play her well, and like today we saw how good Nidalee's can be, she can be a threatening force even in the mid-game.
Jankos, any comments on that?
No, not really.
All right. Amazing, said it all. Finally, Jankos, it was you actually that said in one of the features at the beginning of the season, you know, we got to get top three. This is no longer our first go around the LCS. What do you think you guys have to improve to get that, because you haven't had the perfect start?
Well, I think we are still kind of weak in the early game. We are not really doing much. And then in the mid game, our vision control and map control of all is not the best, you know. So I think we should kind of try to improve our early game and map presence. We should also try to fight a little bit more because we are confident in fights. And then I think we should be able to beat the top teams.
Yeah, like I saw you kind of trying to do something with the any roams, any and... like you roaming around the map, trying to kill mid, trying to kill top, trying to get the turrets. But I actually want to ask about the tank Annie, because quite frankly, he actually built Relic Shield and translated that into Face of the Mountain. Was it a conscious choice because you played Nidalee and basically linked the frontline?
I mean, it was basically because he was trying to engage a lot. And the other thing is that it's good against Leona in the lane because you are not that squishy, so they can't really burst you down that quickly.
All right.
It worked out with a lot of interesting item builds, and well, it definitely did you guys well. Congratulations, ROCCAT, on that victory. In just a few minutes, Gamma Gaming will look to start their climb in the standings against the Copenhagen Wolves. But before we go, we'll hear Cabo Shard reflect on his strongest champion picks we've seen this split.
Well, Cassiopeia is a very, very solid champion overall. Like, in 1v1, she's one of the best. She got really good sustain because of her E. She got good poke with Q that got pretty big range, and her all-in potential with the E that resets with poison is really big. The ultimate is a really big force in teamfight as well, so if you flash and ult, it's pretty easy to predict. But if you ult and flash, yeah, then the enemy can get surprised and people won't have time to react, so you can catch a lot of people with that.
Oh, that's a great start by Cabo Shot!
I still think she will be really good because she still got the same ultimate, the same all-in potential, so just a little nerf on the lane, I guess.